النبي سلام عليك يا رسول سلام عليك يا حبيب سلام عليك صلوات الله.
طيب الحمد لله نحمده تعالى نستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونتوب إليه ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهديه الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة ونصح الأمة فكشف الله تعالى به عنه الغمة صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما مزيدا. أما بعد, all praise is due unto Allah, the Almighty, the Most Merciful, the Most Beneficent. He whom Allah Azza wa Jal guides, you will never ever be able to mislead. Is He who Allah allows to go astray, you will not find for guidance. And I bear witness that there are none worthy of being worshipped but Allah Azza wa Jal, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is His Prophet, His Messenger. And I bear witness that He has conveyed the message as it should have been conveyed, and that He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has done everything that He can do to tell us how to get to Jannah, and He has told us everything that we need to know so we know how to stay as far away from the hellfire as possible. As to what follows, so today was supposed to be the first halaqa from the big announced, I guess really halaqa of the tafsir, not really tafsir, I guess really the explanation of Sahih Al Bukhari. And this is a halaqa that Sheikh Saeed and Sheikh Abu Sumayya were very excited about beginning and starting, subhanAllah. And I've heard discussions for them when they really liked it, and they really were excited about beginning this halaqa in its sense. And it's unfortunate, but unfortunate for you guys, fortunate for me, I guess, really, is that they're not here. That for this weekend here, something came to the both of them up. Inshallah, ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to make it easy for the both of them, inshallah, that they will return bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. So I was asked instead to replace them for the beginning of the for the first halaqa. Wa hada subhanAllah, just like I said to you, unfortunately for you and fortunately for me, that Allah Azza wa Jalla wouldn't allow me, inshallah, to go through unless I get some of this reward bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, if the intentions are pure bi'idhnihi ta'ala. But what I did want to speak about, because once we talk about Sahih al-Bukhari, everyone knows the book itself as a Sahih al-Bukhari. And subhanAllah, it's the book that even commoners, common people, when they talk, they know about it. It's not a book of students of knowledge. And the scholars of religion have all come to a consensus that it is the most authentic book, على الإطلاق, مطلقاً. At all, okay? After the book of Allah Azza wa Jalla, the Quran. So it is the book to go to after the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Mus'haf, the Quran. And this is a beautiful thing, subhanAllah. Yani imagine having to study a book of such magnitude. And the, as you know, the book was not written during the times of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was written a while after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And what I wanted to do today, inshallah, is I wanted to speak to you about the writer, the author of the book itself. And also, I'll try to introduce to the book itself. And if we have time, I'll do a hadith. I'll do the first hadith, if the time comes, inshallah. I don't know how these two mashayikh are going to go through the whole book. It's not a small book. You've seen the book. MashaAllah, it's a good size book. Walillahi alhamdu wal minna. Tayyib. So the author of Sahih al-Bukhari is Abu Abdullah, Abu Abdullah, the father of Abdullah, Muhammad ibn Ismail. His name is Muhammad, the son of Ismail, ibn Ibrahim al-Bukhari. What's his name? Muhammad, okay, because here's the thing, we have a problem here, okay? Many times we always say what Sahih al-Bukhari, and people ask him, who's Bukhari? Bukhari, yaakhi, Bukhari. No, you have to know the name of the scholar. This is not a joker of a man, okay? We have to know the name of him, because yani, subhanAllah, yani, if you look in his book and how hard this man himself has actually worked in picking out the names of the scholars that he learned the hadith from, and all the way up to the companions, and how all of the scholars have paid so much attention to how the sanad, really, I guess, really, this religion, by the way, is about sanad. If without sanad, a religion is gone. So you have to know the names of these men that we are talking about. The least you can learn is the name of the person who has what? Who has authored the book itself. So he is Abu Abdullah. He's the father of Abdullah. What's his first name? Muhammad. Allahu Akbar. What's his father's name? Ismail. Okay, so he's Abu Abdullah Muhammad ibn Ismail ibn Ibrahim. His grandfather's name is Ibrahim ibn al-Mughira. But let's just stay at Ibrahim, inshallah. Okay, so this is sufficient for you to know, inshallah. So his name is Abu Abdullah Muhammad ibn Ismail ibn Ibrahim. Abu Abdullah Muhammad ibn Ismail ibn Ibrahim. So his grandfather's Ibrahim, his father is Ismail, his name is Muhammad, and his son's name is Abdullah. Allahu Akbar. And he's without a doubt from Bukhara, a city, really, in a sense, as they call it, in the what they call east of the river. Anything east of the river is basically what we call really in the Persian side of things. And subhanAllah, one of the amazing things about this man here is that he is a son of a first generation Muslim. So his grandfather was not an actual Muslim. His grandfather was not an actual Muslim. And this is what a lot of the scholars actually say, is that yani, his father was the first one to actually be a Muslim, what, in his generation, in a sense. But yet subhanAllah, him and his the father and the mother, they've worked so hard on bringing this righteous boy to become this kind of imam that he was. And he was one of a very intelligent boy. Yani smartness to the point that people couldn't even believe how it is. And everybody knows the very famous story, even though it's a wrong story. By the way, this story here, لا تصح, it's not accurate. But you know that one time when they brought him in Dimashq, right? And they brought, you know the story, right? They brought him in Dimashq, and they brought 10 people. And to each one of the 10 people, they gave what? 10 ahadith. Okay? And the hadith, nowadays the hadith to us is, you know, an Abdullah ibn Umar al-Khattab, right? This is, no, they give him the whole isnad, everybody who they heard it from, and they mixed up the isnad. In the hadith, every single hadith has two portions, right? An isnad, which is the chain of narration, and what else? What's the second part called? Al-matn. Al-matn is basically the actual text itself. The matn is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself said. Well, isnad is the chain of narration, and that is what? My brothers, this is not the first time I lecture in this place. I know you guys know that I speak back and forth. Wallahi, I'm sorry. It's not going to be good for you guys or for me. If you don't speak to me, I don't even know what's happening. So you have to speak to me. You must speak to me. I don't have any other way around it, inshallah, okay? So, the matn is what? The matn. What is it? What's it in English? It's a text. The text, we call it a text, okay? And unless it's called a text. Well, isnad is chain of narrations, the chain of narrations. So what they did is that they mixed up the chain of narrations for him to mess him up. And so the first one would ask the first, do you know this hadith? And they would tell him the hadith with the wrong isnad. But the hadith is accurate, the matn is accurate. And he would say, oh, I don't know it. And then he would go to the next hadith. He says, oh, I don't know it. And they went through 100 hadith. Each one of the 10 said 10 ahadith. So the amat al-nas, the people, the general commoners who were sitting there, because this was a big imam, everybody was a big deal for him. They said what? They said, what an ignorant man. This guy is ignorant. He doesn't know any of these hadith. They just mentioned 100 hadith they don't know. But the scholars in the gathering, what did they say? قَالُوا لَقَدْ فَطِنَ الرَّجُلُ. This guy knows what's going on. He knows what time of day it is. And when he finished with all of them and he was waiting a little bit, he became quiet and everybody became quiet. He says to him, he spoke to the first guy, he says to him, as for the hadith that you have mentioned to me, and he started saying to him the hadith that he said wrong. It is a wrong hadith, and the right hadith is so and so and so and so and so on. And as for the second hadith, the right hadith is so and so and so and so and so on. So one of the people who are gathering, they said, wallahi, we didn't know what was more intriguing, the fact that he remembered the ahadith one at a time, or the fact that he remembered the wrong asnads. He even remembered what they said that was wrong. So he was an amazing man when it comes to this kind of like nabigha, when it comes to these kinds of
memorizing things. Hatta to the point, subhanAllah, where they say that before he reached the age of 16, he memorized close to 70,000 ahadith. By the age of 16, he memorized close to 70,000 ahadith. And this is an amazing man in terms of, well, they say, some of his the people who used to sit with him in the halaqat, they used to always say, when he was a young boy, he would sit and he wouldn't listen, he wouldn't write down things. And while the sheikh is speaking, he wouldn't write anything, and everybody's writing. And they said to him, you're wasting your time. And he wouldn't answer them. And he would just be listening to the sheikh, speaking the whole time. After 16 days, they kept on bothering him. So he says to them, bring your books, whatever you write on, bring it out. And so they brought everything that they had, and he would remember by the day what are the hadith that were said in the order. So the students said, subhanAllah, they were so impressed to the point where أَخَذُوا يُصَحِحُونَ هُمْ themselves, they would correct the things that they wrote out of his memory. Nabigha. This guy is amazing, crazy when it comes to memory of anything. He's just amazing. And this is the thing that, subhanAllah, that everyone talks about. So when was he born? Does anybody know when he was born? When? 194 after the Hijrah. He was born in the year 194 after the Hijrah. And while he was a young boy, subhanAllah, his father passed away. And his father was a tradesman, he was a tajir. And he had a lot of money, subhanAllah, and he was well off. He didn't have any issues when it comes to money. So they tell the stories that only his mother was the one that raised him. SubhanAllah, I always say, I mentioned Bukhari's story, and I have so much love for the man himself because of his mother. Truly, because, and I believe that nowadays, a lot of our sisters, they go through difficulties, eh? Wallahi bijat, I'm not saying this but the truth of the matter is, living in the West right now, a lot of our Muslim sisters are single mothers. Single mothers. And what they do is, because they're single mothers, they allow themselves to raise mediocre children. They allow themselves, they say, I'm a single mother and I don't have much, what am I gonna do? So she allows for her son to grow however he wants. She allows for her daughter to grow however she wants. But the truth of the matter is, if you look at all of the big, huge scholars, a lot of them, by the way, not just one of them, they were what? They were all raised by, single mothers. I mean, Shafi'i, for instance, is another example of this. He was raised by a single mother. Scholars are not like Hufaz. And when we talk about Hufaz, like it's a big deal. Nowadays, when a mother raises a hafiz, Allahu Akbar. We do, and it's something truly important for her to be happy about. But the truth of the matter is, this is not something that's beyond people's imagination. No, you're able to, my sister, you're able to, my brother, even if you're a single father or you're a single mother, to raise a child that is absolutely beyond anybody's imagination. Why? When you have some sort of vision for him. She wanted her son to be a scholar. And I say, very recent, after his father's passing away, he passed away when he was very young, Al-Bukhari went blind. He went blind. And this is a very famous story, as you know, about him as well. When he went blind, there was no other way for him to get healthy except for his mother would make dua for him the whole night. She would spend the whole night, the story goes that she would spend the whole night crying and making dua for him. SubhanAllah, this is a story that's accurate. Fi Sir Alam al-Nubala, you would read about the history of this man here, where she would spend the night crying, and in one night she had a dream. That whom came to her? Does anybody know? Ibrahim al-Khalil alayhi salam. Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam came to her in her dream, telling her, Ya hada. Yeah, he says to her, oh you, basically. Allah Azza wa Jal has brought back the sight of this boy because of your dua, or because of your buka, because of your dua, or because of you crying. And this is, subhanAllah, a very amazing thing on a woman. And when people tell you, akhi, nowadays, when something big happens, what do people say to you? Say to you, akhi, the least you can do is make dua. And this is a joke of a matter. Anyone who says that to you is a person who doesn't know the power of dua. Because dua is not the least you can do. Dua is the thing you do. That's what you do. That is what you do, and then give me money. You make dua first. If I have a problem, you make dua first, and then you assist me otherwise. You see, right now when people actually, they talk about first what's happening in Syria, what's happening in all these other countries, may Allah Azza wa Jalla, inshallah, grant them all peace, inshallah. The truth of the matter is, you will say, the least you could do is make dua. No, yaakhi, that's not the least. That's the number one thing that you should do. That's what you should do. You should make dua first of all, and then donate money, and then go ahead and help him out. And then all of these other things. Dua is a powerful, powerful thing. And in the very famous hadith on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he said what? That dua, لا يرد القدر إلا الدعاء. يعني دعاء, the only thing that would turn back qadr, really, if it's responded, is what? It's a dua. But the dua itself is qadr in itself. So this woman, subhanAllah, with her dua, she was able to bring sight back to her son. And it was stated about him as he's actually growing up, that when he was younger than 10 years old, he had memorized the Quran in full. And by the time that he was 16, he had khalas, read every single one of the very famous books of a hadith. All the famous books of knowledge, he had read them by the time he's 16. And it was at that time when his mother took him and his brother, okay, he had a brother, his name is Ahmed, she took him and his brother Ahmed to go to Hajj. And when he was there, he stayed. After the Hajj, he stayed because it's a place that he hasn't seen before. So he stayed and his mother returned. He was 16 years old. And he stayed there for 2 years getting knowledge from the people who were there. And that was, subhanAllah, the time when he wrote his big, very famous book. I don't know if you know it or not. He has a book called Tariq. The history, really, in a sense, so it's a history, historical book. When he was what? Between the age of 16 and 18. Very famous book, by the way. This is not a small book. It's a bigger book than the Sahih Al Bukhari. It just basically tells you the actual stories of the whole world and everything in it. Well, subhanAllah, yeah, this is an amazing man. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed a lot of barakah in him from a very, very young age. So, who are his students? Does anybody know of his students? Who is one of his most famous students? Al-Bukhari, who's one of his most famous students? Just think about it. Al-Imam Muslim is one of his students. Imagine yani the blessing that this guy here has had, subhanAllah, that one of his students is what? Is an amazing scholar in the hadith in himself. And they say that Tirmidhi as well is also one of his students. And Muslim, rahmatullahi alayhi, the young Muslim, he used to love him a lot. And they say, it was narrated that one time he saw him. And when he saw him, he walked up to him and he kissed him between his eyes. And he says to him, allow me to kiss your hands. For verily you are the doctor of a hadith. And you know what's wrong with the hadith and what's... Because the doctor, the hadith sometimes has ilal. You guys know what ilal is, right? You guys know... Yeah, the problem, right? So sometimes al-ilal is not something that's very known to everybody. Ilal, for instance, if you know much about ilm al-hadith, for instance, you know that al-ilal are specific issues that only the scholars know about, and the common people don't know. You know, some people, they don't even tell you what's wrong. They tell you this hadith is ma'lul. That's it. You don't need to know anything else. As if, you know, one of the people in it, he's not known. They know him, but they don't know when he met the person he's talking about. So they call this as the illa. We don't know when he met him. This is the illa in the hadith itself. So the man, he called him, and you are the tabib. You are the doctor of the hadith in itself. And we know that Tirmidhi has written a lot of a hadith anhu fi jami' and Nisa'i as well many times. And they say that he used to be... when he would write something new, rahmatullahi alayhi, he would wake up at night time. Many, many times. He would be sleeping at night times and he would wake up to 20 times. He would turn on, and he doesn't have like a light like us flicking the light. He would turn on the siraj, right? And he would write his thoughts and he would go back to sleep. And he would do that in a night 20 times. He said that he would do that in the one night 20 times. He's a man of knowledge without any doubt. And As As you've heard of him, subhanAllah, يعني, many different stories. He was a man who was also wari', he was a man who was very religious man. Some of the stories that go about him, for instance, when they say that one time he wanted to purchase a servant that he wanted to purchase, and he went to the market at that time. You were able to go and buy a servant or a concubine, really, in a sense. And he saw one that he didn't like. He saw one that he didn't like, but as he's talking, he touched her chin with his finger, right? So when this happened, he says, oh, I'm gonna buy her. So they told him, Imam, you don't know, you don't like her. We know you don't like her. This is not the one that you want. He says to him, my finger touched her. Can you imagine this man, he just touches a woman who's not halal for him, touches her chin by a mistake. He makes a determination now he has to purchase her as a servant, and he has to actually to make it even halal or easy for him. And he used to be, yani, subhanAllah, from one of the stories that they say about him is that because he had money, subhanAllah, that he inherited from his father, is that he used to spend for the sake of knowledge. He would travel everywhere for the hadith. He didn't have any problems. He had no issues with money, but he would spend all of his money. So one of the stories that is usually narrated about him is that one time, a person who borrowed 25,000 dinars from him, okay? And he ran away. And Bukhari was a big deal. Even the a'imma and the leaders of the community respected him. So the Sultan, the king, really, I guess, Amir al-Mu'min at that time, caught this man who took the money and ran away. And he said, and that's what happens, he jailed him. So al-Bukhari came to him, and he says to him, Ya akhi, yani, why are you going to jail him? Let him free and I will talk to him. قَالَوْ صَالِحُهُ He said, okay, what are you going to make the sulh upon? He says to him, and he's speaking to the man, he says to him, how about you give me 10 dinars a year? 25,000, imagine somebody, you owe somebody $25,000 and he tells you, listen, give me $10 a year and I'll just let you go. He's an unbelievable kind of a man, really. It's not a in our day and ages type of man, subhanAllah. So they had to, from the continuation of the story, they say that he only paid him once or even twice, and then he told him, khalas ya akhi, I don't even want the rest of the money. I just wanted to kind of like to know really how you would go about this. And he was a man who was wari', and he was a man who was very conscious. From the stories that they say about him, that he had control over his anger as well, is that as he's sitting around teaching in his house, people would be all over, his students would be all over his house. And he had a servant, a jariya, a young one, who walked by, and as she walked by, she spilt the ink. And he got very angry. People could see it in his face, his students. So he says to her, watch how you walk. That's what he said to her. So she was a very smart one. Tama subhanAllah, you always find that smart ulama, they always pick smart servants. She said to him, if there is a way, I would have watched it, but you're filling your house with everybody, and I can't walk anywhere, right? I can't walk it. So she answered him in front of all of his students. So he says to her, you are free for the sake of Allah. So the students said to him, why? And she made you angry, how would you free her? He said, subhanAllah, listen to this. He said, she made me angry, and I made Allah Azza wa Jal pleased in her. Concern is Allah. Sometimes when you're angry, we forget the fact that the concern is who. We want to prove our points. A man gets into a fight with his wife. His point is what? To prove I'm the man. I'm running things here. It's not what's right or wrong. It's me against you, kind of thing, right? That's what happens many times over this sister, for instance. She tarkab rasa. This is what she wants to do something. Okay, and she says, no, it's me against you. You know what I mean? Nobody thinks about Allah. Nobody thinks about Allah. Even brothers, subhanAllah, yani good brothers, when they're against each other, and then kibriya comes, arrogance comes in the middle, my opinion versus your opinion, and they forget about Allah. They forget about Allah. He at this moment, at the time of anger, and in front of whom? Not in front of people who are bigger than him, in front of his students. He's the top man there. He said what? And this is the thing, yani, subhanAllah, the best thing about when you control your anger is what is when you can get angry. Right? Because sometimes you'll be sitting with people who are bigger than you, more pious than you, and then you say, okay, you know what, I can control my anger because you have these people around you. But when you control your anger at a time when you can get angry, and you don't know no one's going to say anything to you, you're the top dog in that place, you're the top man in that place, and you can get angry, and then you control your anger, that's the time that it shows truly your actual control over the anger. طيب, also, one of the things that they speak about how much of a man who was concerned. It tells a story about he had a student of his by the name of Abu Abdullah. And his student was blind. And one time Al-Bukhari called him aside and he says to him, yani, in front of the students, he says to him, yani, Abu Abdullah, I made ghiba about you. Forgive me. And this is his student. So his student, his blind student, he says to him, how did you do it? And what happened? So he says to him, one time I narrated a hadith. And you liked the hadith. You liked the hadith. And you laughed about it and you shook your hands and face. And I laughed because of that. And because you didn't see me, I felt like I made ghiba. Can you see what's going on here? He laughed with someone, not even at him. With someone, but because the person didn't see him, he assumed that would be considered a ghiba. So he asked him to forgive him. And nowadays, wallahi, we eat each other's meats. Eh? Like, subhanAllah, I don't like to speak about that. But the truth of the matter is nowadays, يعني وَلِلَّهِ الْحَمْدُ وَالْمِنَّةِ وَلَيْكَ يَا رَبِّ الْمُشْتَكَى. And the people used to really love him during his lifetime, Abu Abdullah. And they used to really, really respect him, subhanAllah. And they used to really, really appreciate his knowledge, and people would gather around him for يعني, many times. And the story of the book itself, that he says that one time we were sitting with, you know, the Imam Ishaq ibn Rahawi, a very famous hadith scholar as well. He said, "Yani, it would be really nice of you guys if you would make the book that contains only the accurate ahadith of the Prophet." Back in those days, my brothers, let me tell you something here. They didn't differentiate between, but there weren't books that only talked about hadith that are accurate. Because people's level of knowledge was a lot higher. So they would read the hadith, they would know whether this hadith is accurate, sahih or not. They would hear it, they would know. So the scholars didn't have to tell them this. You see what I'm saying to you? Like, subhanAllah, yani, from the things that it was amazing that Al-Bukhari says he used to memorize 100,000 hadiths that were accurate and 200,000 hadiths that were not accurate. More hadiths that are not accurate than the more hadiths that are accurate. And he would memorize them so he would know which ones is wrong and which ones are right. So he says when Ishaq ibn Rahawi, when he said that to him, قَالَ وَقَعَ ذَلِكَ فِي قَلْبِهِ. He said, this is what a good idea. That someone would actually write a book of only the ahadith that are accurate. So imagine how, it was a new idea. It was a new idea. Imagine if this didn't come about. Nowadays, we'd still be looking at the book. Oh, this guy didn't meet this guy. Oh, no, this hadith is not accurate. Oh, this guy could not have said this guy. This guy died before this guy. This hadith is not accurate. Or this guy lived in a different city than this guy. This hadith cannot be accurate, and so on and so forth, right? So, and he gave it a very beautiful name. Nowadays, we only know the hadith as what? The book itself as what? Huh? Sahih Al Bukhari, we call it what? وهذا الحديث صحيح في صحيح البخاري. That's what we say, right? This is what we say. We say it's hadith, this hadith is accurate in صحيح البخاري. And the name of the hadith itself. Listen to this. قال هو اسمه الجامع المسند الصحيح المختصر من أمور رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وسننه وأيامه. This is the name of the book. This is the name of the book. It is الجامع, the collection. Okay, المسند. The ones that attributed to al-sahih and the accurate al-mukhtasar, the summarized one, min umur Rasulullah, from the matters of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, wa sunanihi, and his sunan, wa ayyamihi, and his days. So the name is the collection, basically, of the accurate collection that talks the summarized one about the matters of the Prophet, his sunan and his days. And from that you know what he's talking about. Because once you say Sahih al-Bukhari, people don't really know. Because in it, it's not just only a hadith from the Prophet ﷺ. Sometimes he has what? Things that happened during the times of the Prophet ﷺ that the Prophet is not mentioned actually in it. That the Prophet heard about it. The certain things that happened during the times of the Prophet ﷺ. And the Prophet is not really mentioned because this is also from the sunnah. These hadith sunan iqrariya. You see what I'm saying to you here? So we have to understand the book. Always, always you have to read what the name of the book itself, the intention of the writer itself, what it is, so you can understand what's actually inside the book. And subhanAllah, when I used to study this book, the muqaddama, just the introduction of the hadith of the book itself, we studied that I recall when we had the study, it was in at least 20 weeks. Just the introduction of the book itself, that one we had to study in about 20 weeks. So it's really crucial for you to understand what the Imam wants to do with the book, is for you to know what his intentions behind it and how he actually wrote it and what he wrote about it. So that's the name of the hadith itself, or the book itself. So he says when he wrote it and he started to teach it, and they say while he was writing it, by the way, this is a very interesting thing about it. When he was writing it, every time a new hadith will come about, he will make ghusl. Not wudu, my brothers. Not wudu. He would make ghusl. And he would pray two rak'ahs, and he would write the hadith. Every time a new hadith, he wants to write it, he wants to know whether he included it or not, he would make ghusl. He would make ghusl, and he would pray two rak'ahs, and then he would actually decide whether or not to actually write the hadith itself. And from when he wrote it, subhanAllah, people loved it immediately. And when he was teaching it, subhanAllah, this is not a book that became famous now. This is a book that got famous during the times of the Bukhari himself. So that tells you the barakah of this man. The barakah of this man, subhanAllah, is when you see the fruits of your subhanAllah, the imma al-arba, or even more than them, right? They had followings during their lives. But their followings didn't count in the millions like nowadays. They didn't see it like that. But this man, his book got famous when he was alive. Everybody used to love to come and listen to it, and everybody, and he would teach it. So after he wrote it, he would actually teach it, and he would sit about it. And he used a very unique way in the actual writing and the authoring of the book itself, where he would use the same hadith with a different isnad in a different place. To show you that the hadith, so he wouldn't repeat the hadith, but it'd be the same sanad, it'd be the same matn, but with a different isnad. It'd be same matn, remember what we said, matn is what? Is the actual text, what the Prophet himself said, but sometimes what the Prophet said, more than one companion would hear it, and the companion would travel somewhere else, right? And the other companion would travel somewhere else. One would go to a Sham, and let's say one would go to Mecca. So when he wanted to repeat the same matan, he would use this guy's snat first, then he would use this guy's snat second time. He wouldn't repeat them. To show you what? Sa'at al-ilm, yeah. This guy is a genius. He doesn't even want to repeat that hadith. He doesn't even want to repeat to you the same hadith has been said here, and it's been said here, and it's been said by all of these scholars. So you know what time of day it is. So you know that he knows what it is that he's actually talking about. Rahmatullahi alayhi. طيب. Does anybody know how many hadith he has in there? It's close to 8,000, but there's a couple of hadith that are mu'allaqat. There's a couple of hadith that are actually, there is some sort of ta'liq in them, basically where he, in all, they say it's about 7,600 hadith, or a little bit less than that. Okay? And that's not including the repeated ones, because he said we repeat once with what, with different places. So all of them, they're very, very big hadith. And Ibn Hajar al Asqalani said there are about 7,397 hadith. With the ones that are actually al mu'allaqa, basically it says it's about 1,342 or 41 hadith. And every scholar, when they knew about this hadith, this book, they wanted to explain it. And that's the beautiful thing about subhanAllah. Yani if you look at the other books, you won't find somebody who has explanations as much as this. The most famous of them all, as you know, is the most famous sharh, the most famous explanation. I won't answer that one. You have to know it. This is not something that you don't know. That's something you can't know. Wallahi, you cannot not know this one. The most famous explanation. I bet you the sisters in the back know, inshallah. We should maybe, one of these days, we should hook up a sama'a to them so we can hear. Huh?
You said the most famous?
The most famous explanation of Sahih Al Bukhari. I know it's in the back of the heads of everybody, but this is something that you should really, this, as a matter of fact, it's a book that should be in every one of you guys' library. Fath al-Bari. Fath al-Bari, Ibn Hajr al-Asqalani, guys. This is not a small book, eh? This is a book, this is a huge, humongous book. This is no joke. Explains all of these ahadith, and every one of you guys should have Sahih Al Bukhari in your library, by the way. And every one of you should have the explanation, at least the first one. At least this one that we mentioned here, Fath Al Bari, Al-Hafiz Ibn Hajar Asqalani. طيب. Also, there's another explanation that's been made, Al-Alama Badruddin Ibn Mahmud, Umdat Al Qari, he called it Umdat Al Qari fi Sharh Al Bukhari. And there's another one, it's called Irshad Al Sari ila Sharh Sahih Al Bukhari. And there is Al-Kawakib Al-Darari fi Sharh Sahih Al-Bukhari. And there is Sharh Ibn Munir, as you know, but this is also a nice one. And there's another one that's really famous as well, Sharh Ibn Batal, Sahih Al-Bukhari. So I mean, a lot of scholars, when they come, even know, and that tells you what? When a lot of scholars explain a book, it means what? It means to them it's a very important book. That's literally what it means. It means that it's a very crucial book for them and that they actually think that it's important for them to learn about it and to know about it. I don't know what time Isha is. Yeah. 10 o'clock. Okay, so we have some time, inshallah. طيب. خير, inshallah. Should we begin maybe with the first hadith in it? Or should I leave it to the scholars, our shuyukh? Huh? You tell me. You guys, I give you some time. Do you want me to explain the first hadith or should we leave it for our teachers? Huh? Started? Khalas, khair, inshallah. طيب. Does anybody know what the first hadith is? I don't have the book, by the way. Does anybody know what the first hadith is? Yeah, does anybody know what the first hadith is? But anyways, it doesn't matter whether they have a book or not, we have it, inshallah. Does anybody know what the first hadith is? Allahu Rabbi. إنما الأعمال بالنيات. The hadith is narrated عن عبد الله بن عمر عن عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عن أبي حفص عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه قال إنما الأعمال بالنيات قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إنما الأعمال بالنيات وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى فمن كان هجرته إلى الله ورسوله فهجرته إلى الله ورسوله ومن كان هجرته لدنيا يصيبها أو امرأة ينكحها فهجرته إلى ما هاجر إليه. Listen to this. Verily, all deeds are by intentions. And verily, you will be rewarded based on your intentions. فَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ So whoever immigrates for the sake of Allah and His Prophet, فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ So therefore, his reward would be based on the fact that he went for the sake of Allah and His Prophet. وَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ لِدُنْيَا يُصِيبُهَا And whomever had immigrated for the sake of some sort of worldly gain. أو امرأة ينكحها or to marry a woman. فهجرته إلى ما هاجر إليه. And therefore, his immigration is for whatever he went for. First of all, the narrator of the hadith. The narrator of the hadith. The narrator of the hadith, my brothers and respected sisters, is هو أبو حفص عمر الفاروق. This is Ibn al-Khattab. And he is what? The second Khalifa after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. أول من تسمى بأمير المؤمنين. He is the first one to go by the name of Amir al-Mu'mineen. And he became a Muslim when Islam was still young, when? What happened? Do you know his story? So he became Muslim في دار الأرقم when he had the intention to go and to kill the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And as he's leaving to go and kill the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he runs into one of the companions. Ila ayn, where are you going? He says to him, I'm going to kill this man who has separated us. He has made a mess and a mockery out of us and out of our families and out of our gods. And he says, what does he say to him? Hey, akhi, go ahead and mind your own business first of all. Go ahead and deal with your household. This is a companion who knows what to say, right? Because and the Arabs, subhanAllah, they take care of their business before they go outside. If something is not steady in their household, they won't go and fix it outside. And this should be, subhanAllah, the beautiful things that we should learn. Nowadays, if something is broken in your household, don't go and try to fix it in everybody else's house. You know what I'm saying? Because sometimes our house is destroyed and we just want to go and fix everybody else's house. You hear of the joke of all of the... just as a joke, but the people who are going through demonstrations during the Arabic Spring, as they would call it, all these people are saying, what do you guys want? He said, we want Sharia. And they kept saying, we want Sharia. And as he, subhanAllah, as they're talking about it, then the guy said to him, ya akhi, and he invited him to his house. And when he went to his house, he found that all of his kids are watching TV and they're dancing to to music videos and stuff like that. So this guy said to him, ya akhi, Sharia in the whole country is hard, but this is your house. You run this house. If you can't put Sharia in your house, ya akhi, come on, don't be a joker about the rest of the world. So what did he say to this guy here? He said to Umar al-Khattab, your sister has become Muslima. Go and deal with her. And at that time, subhanAllah, he turned right away and he went to his sister's house. He went to his sister's house, and as he's at his sister's house, subhanAllah, he knocks really, really hard. And she had, what surah was she and her husband reciting? Does anybody know? Guys, Allah, I don't know what's going on with you guys. You're not with me today, mashallah. I know this is the last time I'm going to do this. May Allah Azza wa Jalla forgive you guys. I'm going to leave you to Sheikh Saeed and to Abu Sumayya, inshallah, so they can let you know what time it is, our shaykh. Surah Taha. They had Surah Taha and they were reciting it. And then he heard them reciting it from the door. And then when he walked in, she hid it in her clothing, right? And he was asking her, what is it that you're doing? Is it true that you became Muslim? And all of this big, huge fight ensued between them. I'm just telling you the story of what it is because I want to get to the actual hadith itself. Because we have to know who Umar al-Khattab is before we know what he's talking about when it comes to the actual hadith itself. So he gets into this big huge fight and then he slaps her. And this really hurt his feelings because when he slapped her, the paper fell out of her. SubhanAllah, when he wanted to read it, she said to him, I won't let you read it until you go ahead and you clean yourself up. This is a Quran, is what she says to him. This is not, and you anta mushrikun najis, and you are not pure. You're Muslim. So he wants to know. And subhanAllah, this is what sometimes I need to tell you guys when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants something good for someone, He takes you to it. And you do things that are amazing so you can get to it. And subhanAllah, this is not something that easy. And subhanAllah, you imagine this guy left his house to kill someone. He didn't go for anything else. Evil, the most evil of things that you can do, really, not as easy, you kill someone. But he goes to his sister's house and she forces him to take a shower to clean himself up so he can read the actual book, the Quran. Taha ma anzalna alayka al-Quran litashqa. Imagine this. Taha, we have not brought down this Quran for you to what? To cause you hardships. Calm down. This book from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is for ease. This is good. This is not to cause hardship. This is not supposed to separate between people. This is not supposed to do any of these things. This is something that's good. This is something that's positive. And subhanAllah, it immediately affects people. SubhanAllah, imagine, subhanAllah, nowadays, Arabs or non-Arabs, the Quran doesn't have as much of an effect as it had on the Arabs, even when they weren't Muslims. The Quran back in those days, they weren't Muslims and the Quran was so effective. And subhanAllah, when they talk about the story of Surah At-Tur, when one of the mushrikeen says, he says, I would listen to the Prophet read the Quran. And then he would listen to the one ayah where it says, أَمْ خُلِقُوا مِنْ غَيْرِ شَيْءٍ أَمْ هُمُ الْخَالِقُونَ. He says, when I heard that, قَالَ كَادَ قَلْبِي يَطِيرِ. When I heard that, my heart almost wanted to fly out of my chest. This is not a Muslim. Nowadays, and then I like to compare back at days and nowadays so we can tell what kind of state we're in. You know what I'm saying? And the truth of the matter is, subhanAllah, nowadays we have to like import an imam from far away so we can cry. We have to bring us because wallahi, it's a sad situation that we're in, right? But this, subhanAllah, this a couple of ayat, and Umar al-Khattab immediately says, well, how do I become Muslim? How do I become Muslim? And he is told to go to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And when he goes, he knocks on the door. The companions see him. Who's this, Umar al-Khattab? This is something bad. Umar al-Khattab, by the way, does anybody know what age he was at that time? Guess. Yeah, he was younger than the 30s. Most likely he was about 27, 28. Most likely he was 20. And imagine, 27, 28-year-old would shake up people like that. Right? And this is not because he was a special guy or anything like that, but because back in the days, a man's value started earlier. Yani, subhanAllah, a person was, when he had value, it doesn't matter. And a person who didn't have value, it doesn't matter if he's 60, he doesn't have value. What's the big deal? This is how it is. If you concern yourself with the lowest of lowly things, it doesn't matter if you're 100 years old, you're still a person who's not concerned. But when you're concerned with big, huge matters in the world, even if you're 16, you become scholar. Even if you're 70, people respect what you're saying. And subhanAllah, at that time, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, imagine this. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would make dua for Ahad al-Umarain, any one of the two Umar, the him or? Who's the other Umar? Huh? You guys, wallahi, I'm not happy with you guys right now. I'm telling you guys. No. Huh?
Abu Lahab?
Abu Lahab? No. Abu Sufyan. Naam. What are the two? And who comes to him? Ahabba al-Umarain ila Allah. The one who's most beloved to Allah is Umar ibn al-Khattab. So he comes to him and he opens the door. And what did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? People always talk, by the way, about the strength of Umar ibn al-Khattab. They say he was very strong, right? But do you guys know that, subhanAllah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, by the way, he used to have very, very huge, yani he was very strong himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he holds him from his shoulders and he shakes him down. And he sits him down and he says to him, is it not time for you, Umar? Is it not time for your Umar until he falls down? And you imagine this is the Prophet. This is the time. Khalas, it's time. This is the time. So he says the Shahada, and subhanAllah, yani he says the Shahada. How long does it take for him to say, Khalas, I'm become a Muslim? Did he say, let me go to Medina for 8 years? You know, let me go and. No. Immediately, Khalas, well, right now, he says, are we not on the haqq? Are we not on the true, you know? So she shows you the kind of personality that he is. He now believes in something, he wants to call for it. Khalas, I believe in it, let me go ahead and tell everybody about it. I believe in it. And he immediately says, Akhi, let's calm down, let's think about it. No. Are we not on the haqq? Yes, we are on the haqq. Okay, let's go. And two lines left the house of Dar al-Arqam immediately. One of them was being led by Umar al-Khattab and the other one is led by Asadullah Hamza ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. So we're still talking about the qissa of Islam. So this is Umar al-Khattab. And Umar al-Khattab, subhanAllah, throughout the whole times, ever since he became a Muslim, he became what? A second assistant, a second man in command after the Prophet ﷺ and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq immediately. And when the Prophet ﷺ died, subhanAllah, he became the second man in command after the after Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And he was beloved to the Prophet ﷺ. And many, many times, he would say something and the Qur'an would come and what? Exactly the same words, many times, not once. Even the hijab of the Ummahat al-Mu'mineen, the mothers of the believers, the hijab, it was because of his comment that he has actually made. And in many, many times, he was the one to point out a lot of things, subhanAllah, and he was strong. Radiallahu anhu wa ardah. So he says that he mentioned this hadith, and this hadith, subhanAllah, there's something very weird and very strange about it. Al-Bukhari mentions this hadith as the first hadith in his book. But does anybody know what the first book, the first kitab is called? Kitab Bad al-Wahyi, the starting of revelations. The starting of revelations. And the scholars have always debated, why would they put this, I mean, you know the hadith. The hadith is niyat, it's about intentions, right? So why would he put it in this? Because this is the first chapter. This the first chapter in his book is about Bad al-Wahyi. So the first thing he should start with is Hadith Aisha on, you know, how the Wahyi used to come to the Prophet ﷺ as ringing of all of these things. But no, he began it with this hadith. The scholar says to remind you and I and himself that if the intentions are not pure, don't worry about this book. If the intentions are not pure, don't read the book and I won't write the book. So it's a reminder for him. So you imagine how he puts this hadith as the first one as a reminder for himself to purify the actual intention. To purify the actual intention. And a lot of scholars say that it is for us to be reminded of this matter as well. And the hadith, there's something very funny about it. It's a hadith that is gharib. Do you guys know what gharib means? Like, it's a hadith sahih. But it is only been narrated on Umar ibn al-Khattab. And only one person narrated it on Umar ibn al-Khattab. And only one person narrated on that person, and then from that, it became big. And even though في one of the narrations, Umar al-Khattab says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said this hadith when? When he was on the minbar. This is very strange, because how could it be on the minbar and only Umar al-Khattab mentions it? You see what's going on here? Only Umar al-Khattab mentions it, right? So there's something funny about the hadith itself, but it's an accurate hadith without any doubt. Hadith ahad, it's hadith of, I hope Sheikh Saeed or Abu Sumayyah tells you the difference between what we call hadith al-ahad and hadith al-mutawatira. I can tell you now. It's the right time to tell you, inshallah. So the hadith are broken up into two different types of hadith. Hadith al-mutawatira are basically a hadith that have been told in chains of isnads from so many different types of people that there is no way that they would come up together and say, let's lie to the rest of the ummah. It just wouldn't make sense. Some of them lived all over the world, right? So they heard the hadith from different people, and the hadith is exactly the same way. So those hadith are, without any doubt, are accurate. Because we know, we've heard them from so many different people. Hadith al-ahad are a hadith that come from one person to another person to another person. And those, some of them are accurate, and some of them are not. Some of them are accurate, and some of them are not. And the accuracy always comes from the isnad. This is not something that me and you do. This is something that the scholars themselves actually determine whether the isnad is accurate or not. People who know the names of the men, they know where they lived, they know whether they met each other, they know whether the men were pious or not, they know whether these men were liars or not, they know whether these men used to have students or not, they know whether these men's shuyukh and who they were, where they sat, in which types of... Yeah, subhanAllah, I used to sit with Sheikh Abdulaziz al-Rajhi. May Allah Azza wa Jalla protect him. But he would know even descriptions of the men who are after the companions. He would tell you, no, he was thin, he used to have a white beard, and he used to sit in the corner of the masjid, and he used to... Men who know what time of day it is when it comes to the actual, what, the isnad itself, where it actually is. And this is something that big scholars debate and they talk about. So this hadith here is accurate, clearly now a hadith of what? Mutawatir or ahad? Ahad, yes. Only Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu is the one who actually narrated from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was only narrated by one person. Tayyib, how does it begin? He says, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So now he tells you that I've heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Say, innama, verily, innama, hasr. Hasr, yani basically, it literally says to you, verily all of those, right? Like he's saying, everything. Al-a'malu bin-niyyat. Verily, all single deeds are by intentions. All deeds are by intentions. And intentions, my brothers and respected sisters, are very important for you to understand. We talk, first of all, about intentions of who you do something for. Okay? This is one type of intention. And the second intention is about what is it that you're actually doing. And I want to differentiate between those two very clearly for you to understand. Nowadays we know, for instance, that any deed that you do for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, any ibadah that you do for the sake of Allah azza wa jalla, has to have two conditions, right? The first one is it has to be for the sake of Allah. So this is the intention. The second one is what, do you know? Huh? No. Two conditions. One of them is that it has to be for the sake of Allah. The second one is? The Shaykh will talk about it. It's another hadith that's coming up soon, but you should know about it. It has to be according to how the Prophet taught us how to do it. Right? Yani right now, if I come in here, in this masjid, and I say I'm going to do 20 push-ups for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jalla, and my intentions are pure. Is this an ibadah? No, it's not an ibadah. It's not an ibadah. Because I'm just making it up. The Prophet didn't tell us to do this, right? Or if I say, wallahi, I'm going to come and I'm going to pray standing on my arms. This is not according to how the Prophet has taught us. I'm praying, right? And I'm making it harder even. So it should be more reward, but that's not it. So your ibadat must be according to those two conditions. This hadith affirms the first one of the wali, that it must be for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. It cannot include in it anything else but that. It cannot be, so people look at you and they say, Allah ya akhi, look at how beautifully he prays. At the shirk al-asghar, it's riya. It cannot be because yani Muslims are too many, they're all around me, and if I don't pray, they're going to start talking about me. It can't be because of that, you know. It cannot be because of any of these. It has to be for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jalla purely. When we talk about intentions from the other perspective, however, we talk about the intentions of what we're actually doing. Think about this. Dhuhr and Asr. Four rak'at and four rak'at. What's the difference between them? What's the difference between them? Four rak'at and four rak'at. What's the difference between them? I'm traveling right now. Forget the time. So the time is gone. I come into this masjid at 4 o'clock. I pray four rak'at. Do you know whether I prayed Asr or Dhuhr? Do you know? No, you don't know. So what's the difference? Well, what's the difference between them? Intentions. So here is what we're talking about. So intention doesn't only, it's not only for the sake of whom, it's also about what you're doing. Sah? It's also about what it is that you're actually doing. Four rak'at and four rak'at. Who knows but you? You only know. Yeah, that's nobody else knows. You come in here and you pray two rak'at at 11 o'clock. Is it tahiyat al-masjid or is it duha? Nobody knows. Just you know. So the intentions have to be understood from that those two different perspectives. So they have to be for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, and intentions are a must when it comes to religious matters. A person, for instance, who in Ramadan or outside of Ramadan, for instance, goes to sleep right before Fajr and doesn't wake up until after Maghrib. Right? And he wakes up after Maghrib. And as soon as he wakes up, he has a cup of coffee and tea. He says, Allahu Akbar, I got a reward of fasting a day. Does he get it? Does he get it?
No.
No, because he didn't make any intention, right? A person who jumped in the river, and as he's jumping in the river, he's swimming, and as he's swimming, he's going ahead and making all of the wudu movements, or the washing movements. He gets out, and he hears the adhan. He says, well, you know, I was in the water anyways. Let me go ahead and pray with him. Does it count as wudu or not?
No.
No, because he didn't make the intention. You have to know, my brothers and respected sisters, that intentions are a very crucial part of your religious rituals, that you have to know in what intentions. And intentions are not mentioned when it comes to rituals, ever, except for when? Hajj. Hajj is the only thing, Hajj or Umrah, is the only thing that the Prophet ﷺ has made the intention known. Labbaik Allahumma Umrah, Labbaik Allahumma Hajj. That's what he used to say. But he would never stand and say, before Salat al-Fajr, because sometimes I hear this, subhanAllah, you know, and people will come to Asr, al-Dhuhr, and say, you know, Nawaitu an usalli Salat al-Asr, arba'a rak'at sirran lillahi wahdahu fi masjid al-Sakinah khalf al-Imam Sa'id Raghi. Wallahi, I hear, sometimes you hear these kinds of things, right? People, you say, what's going on, yaakhi? What are you doing? You make it tasmi' for some sort of surah? No, I'm just making it. So all of these have never ever been done by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The only imam who said that, yeah, subhanAllah, and this is a mistake by the way, from the Shafi'iyah. Shafi'iyah, they say that the intention should be actually uttered, and they don't have proof for it. Or they have proof for it, but they're not accurate. The accurate opinion is the fact that you don't actually have to utter the intention of anything, because intention is in your heart. Intentions are in your heart. Yani right now, if I know, tomorrow I have to come back to work, okay? I'm not gonna go home before I go to sleep and say, you know, subhanAllah, nawaitu an asbih bukra ashan, so I can go to work. No, nobody will ever do that. Nobody will ever say that. The truth of the matter is that I know when I go home and I put my head to, everybody in my house knows, my wife knows, my kids know, everybody knows that when I go to sleep, when I wake up tomorrow morning, I have to go to work, and this is known by the intention, inshallah. I know that Aisha time, inshallah, it's here. So we'll stop here, bi'inillahi ta'ala. Next week, inshallah, Sheikh Sa'id or Sheikh Abu Sumayya will continue on in the expression of the hadith. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Barakallahu feekum, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum.
يا نبي سلام عليك يا رسول سلام عليك يا حبيب سلام عليك صلوات